off again for another solo. In the woods. You know, there's a lot of different things in my first aid kit. Handle all kinds of minor little emergencies and whatnot. Deal with various ails and so forth. In fact, I might even do a video on it sometime, but none of the medicines in there are as good as just being out here. Well, it seems like I'm not the first one to be using these woods for camping in. Whoever made this bushcraft shelter absolutely knew what they were doing. Obviously, I won't be disturbing it none. Any more than I'd want someone to disturb my camp. But it is a beautiful thing to see. And well camouflaged too. seen somewhere else like this as a camping spot before. Left you some nice cordage, so we'll make use of that. But in the meantime, having cleared a patch of ground, I'm going to set up my tarp tent and my sleep system. I tend to favor the tarp tent over conventional tents as it's more flexible and there's more options depending on the exact conditions and the weather. Tonight is going to be very cold, possibly below freezing, so I'll be setting up an enclosed tarp tent design with a floor. Now, this particular design only requires one pole. Because of the position of this tree, I'll use that instead, so I don't need to use any poles at all for this one. And the design I'm going to use is a tarp tent design which is enclosed and has a floor. Now, the tarp that I use, you'll notice, is black on the outside, silver on the inside, so it reflects body heat rather beautifully. That should keep me nice and toasty. It's approximately 3 meter by 3 meter, or about 10 foot by 10 foot, there or thereabouts. And it allows a lot of flexibility in design. In fact, I should move this a little further back. That's a little more room up there. Looking at this, those trees are a little close together, so I'm going to reorient the entire system a little bit. For this particular tarp tent, I've staked my tarp down in 3 points. One corner, the other corner, and halfway along the front. What I'm going to do now is attach cordage to the middle portion and bring it up to form something of a pyramidal shape, slightly offset. And of course, underneath the tarp, where I'm going to be sleeping, where my body footprint is the very inexpensive tarp, which is only about as wide and as tall as I am. Release knot that uses a small toggle, sometimes called a wee stick. And which will attach this corner. You'll notice the silver side is up right now because that's going to form the inside of the tent, keeping me warmer at night. The black outside, keeping me lower profile. From the opposite side, you already have something of a lean-to. When I take this material and pull it over, this could be fastened down here to form the wall. This piece of material forms the door. In order to make it a bit more spacious inside, I'm going to attach a clip to the center point of the tent and have that pulled out a little bit. Tarp clips can be just a real help, particularly if you have a less expensive tarp that doesn't have quite as many attachment points. It means it doesn't need to be an issue. Going to close up the front. once that's a little secure, we can get the right tension. That's given us a lot more space here, and I think I'm going to do perhaps the second one in this position to open it up inside a little bit more, giving me lots of room inside. Time to set up the sleep system. Now, one thing I will tell you is that a lot of inflatable mattresses that are really good are also really expensive. And a lot of the ones that are not so very expensive aren't particularly good. So there's a dilemma. But there's an easy fix. I have a self-inflating mat which weighs twice as much as these two blow-up ones. These are much more compact. And the two of them combined, as I say, weigh roughly half what my self-inflating mat weighs. But if I blow these up, well, let me show you. These don't take too many breaths. 15, 16 puffs, and it's fully inflated. One of the things about this is it has lots of little air pockets. Now, those pockets mean that you have part of your mat, which is inflated, and part of it is, you have peaks and troughs. So these two inflatable mattresses, which I got off of Amazon between them, because they were on sale, cost me less than $40. And because of the way they're made, they have little pockets, so you have peaks and troughs. And because of that, you can, when you place one atop the other, the peaks of the one fill the troughs of the other, making the whole thing far more comfortable. Now there's another advantage as well, two other advantages in fact. Now one of the advantages of using the two air mattresses, one atop the other, is that first of all the troughs, which aren't necessarily as comfortable as you want them to be, and can allow your body to touch the ground at times, are filled by the other airbag. As a result, you have a more uniform cushion of air, and there are two of them, and it just protects you from the cold of the ground that much better. Also, it makes for a more comfortable experience, because the part where it would have been no cushioning suddenly has cushioning. There's also another advantage as well. If you've ever used an airbag on any kind of regular basis, you will be aware of the fact that sometimes they get punctured. And sometimes they lose that air in the middle of the night. And that makes for an uncomfortable night's sleep and not so nice the next day. By having two of them, even, heaven forbid, one of them should get punctured, you're still going to get a good night's sleep because you're still on a good cushion. One of these is sufficient, theoretically. Practice, it's more comfortable with two. And you avoid the risk of, if there's a puncture, I'm going to have a bad night's sleep. So the two of these combined are significantly less expensive. I mean, some inflatable air mattresses can cost $200, $300, $400. This is less than 40 for the pair of them. And they weigh half what my self-inflating mat weighs. And they take up a fraction of the space. So on a really practical basis, although it may seem overkill, in fact, it's a more practical solution than you might have thought. Now that, combined with a nice down bag, not so much space, not so much weight, but a nice warm night. As I say, it's going to get below freezing tonight, so a warm night will be greatly appreciated. Tripod, and then by attaching this lovely piece of material. A few years ago, while perusing in a charity shop, I came across this. Unused, brand new, and dirt cheap. It is, in fact, a backpacking portable barbecue. And I was thrilled to find it. Well, I don't think they still make these. I believe it's a discontinued model. But there are plenty of various grills available that you can use. And tonight, for dinner, we're going to have a barbecue. And the first thing to do is to set up the barbecue. And then while that's getting all heated up, we'll prepare some food. This one here is particularly nice because it just hinges and then you have four pins that slot in to hold it together. What I particularly like is that these pins, if I can get them in right, then act as little feet, which keep it just off the ground, which is obviously good. Before I light this, obviously, I'll use my little rake that I made to make sure we have a nice clear patch of ground. And that will mean things will be nice and safe, but obviously we'll also, as one does, keep some water on hand in case any sparks go where they definitely should not be. In my previous video, I actually made a charcoal chimney. A link to that video will be in the description. And we're going to use that charcoal chimney to light our charcoal for tonight's barbecue. I'm also going to make the best tasting hamburgers it is possible to make using my barbecue sauce, which simply is wonderful. And I'll give you the recipe, because I'm nice. You should appreciate that. Now the charcoal chimney I have in this little stuff bag, which prevents any charcoal dust from getting in with my kit. That's the bottom, that's the top, and this little bracket on the side allows us to manipulate this when it's hot with a multi-tool. In the bottom portion, first of all, I have a few spare pieces of coal, so that we could make a slightly thicker pile, adding to what's in the main chamber. And we have some fire lighters. I'm going to get all that out for a second. We're not going to use all the fire lighters. We'll probably just use the one. And this is full of charcoal, but I'm just going to add a few extra pieces to the top, so we're going to have plenty. It is a very small container, but again, for two people, it's plenty. For one person, it's plenty, and I'm only one person today, so once that fire lighter is lit, by having this on top, the heat will be drawn up through a convection current. And once that convection current has drawn everything up, it'll light the charcoal. When the charcoal's lit, we use our multi-tool to pick the chimney up and pour the contents into the bottom of the barbecue, where it will do its thing. In order to light the barbecue, I'm going to use my tinderbox, made in a in an 18th century style. If you'd like to know more about this tinderbox, again, there's a link in the description to my video that tells you all about it. It is a more primitive way of starting the fire. But also, I have to say, a little bit more satisfying. And at this point, for reasons best known to itself, my microphone decided to stop working for a time. So we are using voiceover now to explain what you're seeing. Now, what I'm holding there is my barbecue sauce, and arguably a good barbecue sauce makes all the difference to a really great barbecue. This particular one is one of the best, and it's made from only three simple ingredients: teriyaki sauce, hoisin sauce, and sweet chili sauce. One part of each, nicely blended together, and you're good to go. What I'm going to be using this with is some minced beef, where we've got 250 grams of 5% fat minced beef. Now, this is just over half a pound. It'll make two burgers just over the quarter pounder size. And normally, of course, we would be thinking in terms of brushing the sauce onto things we're making, such as steak or chicken. But in the case of hamburgers, because we're going to be kneading it, we're going to pour sauce into it and infuse it. Now, normally I would do this in my kitchen and then take it out to the barbecue at home. And in between the one thing and the other, I'd be washing my hands. Of course, in the middle of the woods, we have no option to do that. And of course, while I've occasionally been accused, rightfully so, of carrying too much in my pack, the actual kitchen sink itself is simply going too far. So these nitrile gloves that I'm putting on are the ideal solution to keeping good fingertip sensitivity for what I'm doing, and yet keeping both the food clean from anything that might be on my hands, and my hands clean from things like whatever fat or sauce or what have you I'm going to be handling now. So we get the gloves on, and then the next thing is we're going to open the packet of beef. And when we take the beef, what we're going to start to do is knead it into a more uniform ball. So here we are opening the packet. We're going to remove all the packaging, and we'll begin to knead it into a ball. And one of the things we'll then do is create a depression in the middle of that ball. We'll give it a somewhat bowl-like shape. And the idea behind that is that's someplace where we can take some of our sauce and put that in with the meat, and then by carefully rolling the meat around the sauce, creating a sort of a ball with the sauce inside, we can then carry on with kneading, and this will infuse the sauce in the bowl. Of course, a little bit will drip out, and if you're doing this at home, bear that in mind. Don't do it over any surface that can stain easily. Of course, in the woods, that's not quite so much of a problem. So we've added our sauce there, and now we're going to just gently roll that in and then begin to knead it together, creating the infusion. And we're actually going to do this twice because we want plenty of sauce in there. With only 5% fat, the burgers would normally come out just a little bit dry, but by putting two lots of sauce into the meat, we add a lot of moisture. And of course, once it begins to cook and the outside begins to sear, that will lock the moisture in, which is why we only really want to give it a couple of minutes on either side. And we're just about ready now, as you can see, to pour in a bit more sauce. And we're not going to use all of it. We're going to use a fair old amount, but we're going to hold some back to put in on the burger with the buns. And here I am now just forming the first burger, and that's on the flame. And now we'll take the second part of the meat after we've split it in two, create that into another patty, and that'll go on the fire. Just about ready now. And onto the grill it will go, where again the one side will begin to sear, and after about a minute or two we will flip them over to sear the other side and lock all that moisture inside. Because it's only a small barbecue with a relatively small amount of coal, these will cook a little bit slowly, and because they're going to cook slowly, they'll cook evenly. The flavor will be wonderful, and the texture as well, because of the extra moisture we're putting in. And as you can see, now I'm taking my gloves off, I have a pair of hands which are clean and dry and will not get the tools mucky. nice thing about cooking over only a small amount of coal is that it cooks a little bit more slowly, and that just makes it taste better. You can burn things if you have too much coal. It gets too hot. But these are good thick burgers. And they're over more than enough coal to cook them, but not so much as to incinerate them. There really is nothing like eating outdoors. Yeah, having had the one burger, on the other one in a moment. In the meantime, we'll have the kettle on, and that'll heat up the water nice and slowly, but by the time we're ready for a brew up, we'll be having a nice hot cup. A good burger, a nice IPA. This one's Brooklyn Defender, which seems somehow appropriate, bearing in mind that, although I haven't lived there since the 70s, I am originally from Brooklyn. Good flavors. Just doesn't get better than that. What I'm going to do though, I'm going to remove the grill at this point. To put the kettle directly on the coals. Which will heat that water up that little bit quicker, and it'll get that brew on just that little bit sooner. And once we finish this meal, just a good old-fashioned nice cup of tea, maybe a little cherry bakewell tart, will make for an excellent dessert. nice cup of tea. Cherry Bakewell Well Protein Bar, not quite a cherry Bakewell tart, but near enough. Perfect way to finish the day. Surrounded by nature. Peace and quiet. This doesn't get any better, does it? Cheers. Doesn't look it, but it's lit. It was. It is. Think about alcohol stoves, they don't look lit until they're fully primed, and then it'll be a bit more obvious. But that is actually going. It's a cold morning. And priority number one is to get a good hot brew on. Like a good cup of coffee first thing in the morning, particularly when it's really cold. A minute, we'll make breakfast. Got scrambled eggs, which I eat so. And after that, I guess we'll clean everything up, pack everything down, and hike on back into normal daily life. But for the moment, the peace and beauty of the woods, the sound of the stream, the taste of the coffee, that'll do for now. get better than this. Oh, that's good. Just that right blend of warm. Spicy, not too much though. It's nice. Get another brew on as well. Good way to start the day. No trace, so put everything back to how it was. And now, as you can't tell, we were here, it's time to leave.